done of. We don't have a couple of things we don't have today.
Okay. Cool. We're good to go. Check 1, 2, 3. Check, check.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to United Methodist Church, where we are leading people to be shaped by Jesus so they can share their faith and spread God's love. We are a community of faith for all people and glad you have chosen to worship with us today, whether it's online or in person. If you're a guest, we would love to give you an opportunity to learn for us to learn more about you, and we invite you to fill out a contact card, which are in the back. On that table, I believe, or as you're coming up the aisle, and you can tell us something a little about yourself, and we'd love to contact you. Okay, so if you could all stand for the call to worship. Praise be to God who has called us together.
We come here seeking healing and hope.
Open your hearts to God's redeeming love.
Help us to hear your words, O Lord, and follow your ways.
Amen. Okay, remain standing for our next song, first song.
Holy is the name of the Lord.
good way to get us started for sure. Okay, continue to stand for our opening prayer. Lord, we come to you today with so many things on our hearts. You call us to be in relationship of trust and love with you and offer healing to us for those portions of our lives that are broken and injured. Help us to be open to your mercy and healing love. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, you can be seated.
Well, now that we're getting back to some normalcy, can I get an amen?
Amen.
We've not been able to do our OSEF offering, and so we're going to do that now. And so the kids came up away from their class for just a few moments to come and see you so that we can all give generously to the Ortonville Community Emergency Fund. Awesome. Thank you for being so generous, and thank you, kids, for helping us out with that. We know that you will have a great time downstairs, so, all right. Give praise. We have a new teaching schedule for the fall, and so we have most of our teachers that have been with us in previous years, and then a couple new ones that have stepped on board, and then we also have teachers' assistants this year, which in some cases are the kids, the older kids of some of our parents who teach the class, and then we have a couple of our youth, three of our youth that are volunteering as well to help out downstairs in that time. So God bless them all. Well, we give thanks to God for the many, many ways that we minister and do ministry in this church, and we have much to pray, give God praise for, as we did in that song. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We do, very much so. I just have one prayer request, at least present with me, that is from Hunter Parker, and he wanted you to know that he is going to Kalamazoo in a training center for the blind to learn life skills, how to be more independent. And he says, I need prayer that things will go well. I don't have any issues as I had back in 2015. So I'm praying that God will get me through these 9 months. I will learn, and that Hannah, his girlfriend, will be okay while he is away as well. So please lift Hunter in your prayers. I know he appreciates that also. And continue to lift the Geisbart family in your prayers. Dane's memorial service was last week. The committal service has not happened, or the burial, because Liz went into the hospital, as many of you know, the day before the service. And so she is doing well. I heard she is at a rehab place. So please pray for Liz. And then hopefully in the next few days we'll be able to get her home so she can have some closure as well. So please pray with her. 75 years is a long time to be together, isn't it? And so to lose someone, I can only imagine what that feels like. So God bless her. And let's just go to a time of prayer and reflection. Mm-hmm.
patient God, we want to have things go well. We want everyone to be happy. We want everyone to be content. But all too often, we stand in the way of our own peace and hope. Lord, we recognize today that, especially as we, in light of the scripture that we are going to look into, that life is not a fantasy in which everything turns out just right. We know there's strife, there are struggles, and sometimes we stand in the midst of them, as I'm sure many are this day. Our hearts and spirits carry the scars of struggles and disappointment that have been born into our lives. Today we come to seek restoration. We come to seek reconciliation and a deeper relationship with you and with others. We want to overcome, God, the barriers which prevent us from being people of compassion and hope, and because there is so much that needs to be done to aid in the cause for peace and justice around the world, in our nation, and in our own community. God, help us to be those who recognize injustice when we see it, and those who would bring hope. Give us courage to become your disciples who follow your way and your will. We ask for prayers for those in need this day. We pray for Hunter, and we give thanks for his opportunity to be able to grow and to look forward to becoming independent. God, be with him and guide him. We pray for Liz as she journeys through this time of grief and such an elder in her elder years. We pray for the loss that she feels, and Lord, pray that you would surround her with your hope and your care, healing physically we ask for, and of course we pray for spiritual healing. We know, O God, that she trusts in you for faith and knows that one day she will see her loved one again. We pray for all those who journey with those who mourn and those who grieve. And God, we give you thanks for the many ways that you continue to thrive here in this place, through our ministries with children, with young people, with adults, in the many ways that we encourage leading, growing, and learning in faith. We pray this and ask this in Jesus' name, who is our Savior, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. We're going to sing a song of preparation, so get us prepared as we hear God's word, and you can remain seated as we sing it. Through It All is kind of, might be familiar to you. It's in the hymnal, but it's only the chorus, so we are going to sing some of the verses today as well, so.
Never.
Today's scripture lesson comes from the book of Job, chapter 1, 1 through 3, and chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. In the land of Uz, where there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and he had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. On another day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them to present himself before him. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. And he still maintains his integrity, though you incited me against him to ruin him without any reason." "Skin for skin," Satan replied, "a man will give all he has for his own life. But now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, then he is in your hands, but you must spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. Then Job took a piece of broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." He replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Pat, for stepping in today. And Jim and Todd as well, and thank you to Piper. I just threw that song at her this morning, so I think she did a pretty awesome job. So, yep. So, well, here we go. 4 weeks into Job. And if anybody has any familiar with Job, you might understand my thoughts, because we're going to spend 4 weeks in probably one of the most difficult books in the Bible as we look at the series called Born to Trouble, and today, Job's test of faith. Why? Well, a couple of reasons. One, because it's on the lectionary, and I'm actually following that for the next few weeks, so yeah, sometimes it's pretty amazing what God will do, even when you're not sure you want to go there. But more importantly, I think Job probably connects to most of us in some way. And if you don't understand now, maybe I hope by the end that you will. But because we've all dealt with trials and struggles and difficulties in our life, right? And so as we begin to look at this, we're going to be in chapters 1 and 2 just for this week. And it starts and ends like a fairy tale. There once was a man named Job who lived in the land of Uz. Kind of sounds like Oz, doesn't it? It's not the land of Oz, by the way, just so you're wondering. He's not the man behind the curtain, but it is the land of Uz, a place in the eastern Mediterranean. There's a couple disparities on where exactly the location of it is, but we do know that it existed. And the last verse of this book tells us that Job lived 100 and 40 years after that, living to see 4 generations of his children and grandchildren. Okay, amen. We'll just quit right there, right? We'll just throw out the rest of the middle of the book. But isn't that awesome? I mean, it is kind of like a fairy tale, isn't it, in a way? Because isn't that what we want? As I said in my prayer, we do want the blessed life and how to be more blessed than to live so many years and see generations. Well, how many of you know that Job is really not a Hallmark movie? Sorry to disappoint you. Because in that last verse, Job lived 140 years. It says, after that, after what? Job is a reminder of every human experience of suffering ever imagined. And Job's troubles begin with a heavenly council or a meeting. Now, that's kind of interesting for us Methodists because we like meetings. And so here we go. That's affirmation right there. And the council gets together. It says, one day the members of the heavenly court came to present themselves before the Lord, and the accuser, Satan, came with them. Now, in this time when the scriptures were written, and Job being one of the oldest books in the Bible, it's not first, but it is the oldest that we know of, there was this idea that there was a divine council. And God spoke of this often in scriptures. And the term used by Hebrew Bible scholars is the heavenly host. And if we go to when Jesus' announcement of Jesus' birth and the heavens opened and the heavenly host sang, right? It is an assembly of divine beings that are to administer the affairs of the cosmos under Yahweh, the God of Israel. And those present in this little meeting of sorts were the angelic beings, or what we call angels. Now, there's another term called sons of God, and I won't get into that, but they were present, these divine beings that interact with people on earth. And then there was God, of course. Got to have a chair. And then there was Satan. Now, this gives us a clue to the trouble that is brewing, because God poses a question to the uninvited guest, or maybe invited, who knows? And Satan responds. When God says, "Where have you come from?" to Satan. And Satan says, "I've been patrolling the earth, watching everything that's going on here and there and everywhere." Now, we can surmise that Satan was up to no good, because we're familiar with Satan, or the accuser, or the deceiver, the many names that he has from Genesis, right? The Garden of Eden. And how he tempted Adam and Eve. So we can guess that he is up to no good, or at least wanting to be up to no good. And then God does a most peculiar thing. He brings attention to Job, one of his most faithful that walked the earth. There was none like him. The Lord asked Satan, "Have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all of the earth. He is blameless, a man of integrity. He fears God, and he stays away from evil." You might know somebody like that. Not perfect, but someone who has great integrity, who is blameless and fears God. You know, there's been lots of study by many theologians on why God would even do this to begin with. Here, hand him on a platter. In case you haven't noticed, but we know that the devil notices, right? Notices everything, especially his faithful servants. He basically handling Job, his servant, over to the one whose only task is to bore trouble into the world. We might recall the words of Jesus when he said in Matthew 16 or John 16, "In this world you will have trouble," right? You will have many trials and sorrows. The fact is, we don't live in a perfect world. Who has ever had a difficulty in their life? Is there anybody here that's ever had a difficulty in your life? Okay, raise your hand. If you don't, God bless you. The fact is, we don't live in a perfect world. And Christianity is not a free pass to a trouble-free life. Sometimes we can come into Christianity or receive Christ and think, "Oh, it's going to be so great all the time. Oh, I wish," right? calamity comes to both the faithful and the unfaithful. Calamity comes to both the faithful and the unfaithful. Even the health conscious can succumb to illness. The one who exercises, who eats right, who does it all. And then there's the one who's the smoker. They've been smoking for 95 years. And the doctor says, why don't you quit? It's bad for you. Really? It is, but even the safety conscience can suffer an unforeseen accident, right? Even the most faithful can see affliction. And being a follower of Jesus doesn't mean that we are immune to suffering. But there is a way to overcome and to bring good news to the world in the midst of our suffering. You see, our trials are the greatest test, I believe, for every believer. Not because of just what we're going through, but because people are watching us in the midst of trouble. Like we can guess, people were watching Job as he experienced the worst. Do we abandon our faith? Do we turn from God? Or do we, like Job, praise God in every situation? I had a friend who's a pastor, a father of some friends of ours, and he said, he would just say, it's a praise the Lord situation, no matter what was going on. Satan's whole objective is to get the most faithful on earth to sin and curse God. If he can do that, then no one is safe or untouchable. And so he afflicts the most excruciating pain and suffering that any person has ever experienced, well, almost, because we know someone else who suffered the worst. But until now, it's Job. Now, it's easy to praise God and the blessings, isn't it? It's easy when things are going well and we feel blessed. But what about when trouble comes? You see, Job's life is a test of faith like no other. In all of it, Job praised God. Go to verse 1, chapter 21. It says, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Say it with me. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I think we just sang that, didn't we? Yeah, I think we did. I don't know what you're going through, but Job has much to teach us about faithfulness and trusting in God's power to redeem, to restore us from anything, especially from our own sin. Pray with me for a moment. God, in this time, help us to hear your word to each one of us this day. Amen. Verse 1 tells us that Job was blameless. He was blameless. He was a man of complete integrity. He feared God, and he stayed away from evil. Now, there's three things about Job that I want us to look at for a few moments this morning. His piety, his prosperity, and his predicament. His piety, his prosperity, and his predicament. Now, if you're a note taker, you'll like all the P's that I give you today. But anyway, it just worked out. Now, predicament's probably not a great word because it's really a lot worse than that, but it had a P in it, so I liked it. So that's what we're going to look at. First, we look at Job's piety. What does that mean to be pious? It is a way of life. One definition, it says it's a devoted reverence toward God evidenced in one's conduct and life. A devoted reverence toward God evidenced in one's conduct and life. Job, we learn, was blameless and upright. The Bible Knowledge Commentary says that he was without moral blemish or morally whole. Doesn't say perfect, it says morally whole and upright, meaning straight in the sense of not deviating from God's standards. He stayed on the path. He was a person of known integrity. His words and his action and his life all showed his faith in every way. In chapter 29, verse 21, it says that Job writes, everyone listened to my advice. They were silent as they waited for me to speak. Job was highly respected. He was fair. He was honest. Job 29:7 says, "Those were the days when I went to the city gate. I took my place among the honored leaders." Job, secondly, we learned, feared God, and he turned away from evil. To fear God's might is to have a deep reverence towards God. And all that we can do, we think that God created everything, you and I, that should give us an awe, a feeling of awe and reverence. And I'll tell you, it's something that's missing in the culture today. It's missing in our young people. It's missing in our, I forget the names for all the generations in between, and even in our elderly. To fear God. To fear God. I think if we feared God more, maybe this world would be a better place. Because the fear of God is to place him, is to place worship above all else, above everything else. Jesus told the woman at the well, it's in John chapter 4, 24, and he's speaking with her about this, and we know some of the issues maybe that she had. And they start talking about this idea about worship. And Jesus said, "For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." To fear God is to place worship above all else in your life. Now, worship is what we're doing today. And worship is the way we live as well. There are many ways to worship and show reverence toward God. And then we see that to fear the Lord is to turn away from evil things. It's to turn away. It means we're going to confront them. That's just part of life. But it means to take a turn away. Proverbs 8:13 says, "All who fear the Lord will hate evil. Therefore I hate pride, arrogance, corruption, and perverse speech." Now Job was righteous. He was blameless. He was a true worshiper of God, and he kept himself from all evil. Clement of Alexandria tells us that. One of the second century, third century theologians. He was a worshiper of God, and he kept evil. He kept himself from all evil. Job was not perfect. He was not above reproach. Thomas Edward Frank argues that no one is really like this, blameless and upright, who fears God and turns away from evil. Might be some argument there. But his basis is that human failing is prevalent. It's all too prevalent. And even Job here in chapter 42, 6 says, "I took back everything I said, and I sit in the dust ashes to show my repentance." Even Job needed a repentant life. But Job just had his priorities straight. And God knew of Job's faithfulness because he says, "Have you noticed my servant, Job? If there is a man who deserves God's favor, it's Job." Then we look at Job's prosperity. He had 7 sons, 3 daughters. We can guess some grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Who has grandchildren? Great-grandchildren? Oh, sorry, that was me. Any great-great-grandchildren, anybody? Okay. So we got some greats. I just did the funeral. Well, it was for Dane. Great-great-great-grandchildren, I think is what it was. Guess when you've been around that long. He also owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, 500 female donkeys. He had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in the entire area. Job was blessed with family, and he was blessed with finances. Job had it all. Job was generous. In chapter 31, verse 16 and 17, he says, "Have I refused to help the poor or crush the hopes of the widows? Have I been stingy with my food and refused to share it with orphans?" No. Job is truly under God's blessing. He has sown and is reaping well, and he is rewarded for his faithful life. Doesn't it make us think that how has God blessed you? Boy, could we write a list? I hope our list would be longer than our list of complaints. We'll get to that later in Job's story in a couple weeks. But we need to know that living faithfully isn't a free pass to being saved. Living faithfully isn't a free pass to being saved. In other words, doing good and doing all the good we can, which is what we should do, and living to strive and to worship God and be blameless and upright is all good, but it will never save us. Job knew that. Only God can save. If that were not so, Jesus would have never came, would have never had a reason to come. If man could save himself, or woman could do all the right things to save themselves, there's no need for Jesus. But we know there is. Job's piety, Job's prosperity, and now we look at Job's predicament. It rises out of two meetings of this heavenly court. Both times, God offers a challenge, offering up his finest to Satan. And we're just looking at the second meeting in chapter 2. But let me tell you, the first time, he hits Job really hard. He hits him in the pocketbook. He takes away everything that he owns. He kills his servants, all his finances, all his workers. His way to make an income is gone. Now, a true test of faithfulness comes in losing a job, doesn't it? Losing a means to a way of life. There's one thing that will hurt a man's pride the most, and I know because I am one, if I can't ever provide for my family. And men, if you've ever been there, it's a hard place to be. And it takes faithfulness. But the adversary doesn't stop there. He takes away his family, his children, except for his wife. Now, there's got to be a hidden message in there. I'm not sure what that is, but his wife's still around. We'll see that later. And through all of this, the worst of all of it, some of you know you've lost children. Unbearable. Job never wanes in his faith. Chapter 1, verse 20, it says that Job stood up and tore his robe in grief. Didn't say that Job didn't sorrow. Job didn't grieve. He shaved his head. He fell to the ground, and then what did he do? He worshiped. Thank you. Where else can he inflict suffering? Satan answers God's challenge and God's response. Satan replied to the Lord, "Skin for skin, a man will give up everything he has to save his life, but reach out and take away his health, and he will surely curse you to your face." God says, "All right, do with me as you please." The Lord said to Satan, "But spare his life." There are a couple things we don't want to miss in this story. One, and if you take anything away, just hold on to these two. God is always in control of this heavenly court. He's in control of the conversation. He knows who Satan is. He is granting permission. Yeah, he's allowing him the freedom to roam and upon the earth. But God's unswerving confidence in Job's integrity tells him, I guess, that he is the one to show what it means to be faithful. And despite the pain and the suffering, God puts Job into Satan's hands for a crucial test. But still, God limits Satan's power, doesn't he? He limits his power. Remember that if you're going through struggles or trials. And secondly, remember this, God never lays a hand on Job. Do you notice that? God never lays a hand on Job. Who's doing all the harm? Satan. God does not inflict harm to those he loves. Spare his life, he commands Satan. Do what you want, test him, but don't cause his death. Now we can begin to see a foreshadowing of Jesus' story and Job's story, of Jesus' life. Jesus who died and was victorious over death. Because of God's love, death and suffering do not have to have the final word. We say that at funerals often, because Jesus is the way to eternal life. So Satan left the Lord's presence, and he struck Job with terrible boils from head to feet. Job scraped his skin with a piece of broken pottery as he sat among the ashes. Does that make you cringe to read that? It should. It's awful. You ever heard of the elephant's disease? Remember the movie The Elephant Man, I think it was? Was out years ago. Anybody ever heard of that? That's what this is kind of connected to. The swelling, the scabs, the pain, the suffering, the scraping. Oh. And not that, just that, but the humiliation upon the loss. Job, who was honored and respected in his town, now becomes an outcast. And as history goes, it said he was outcast outside of the community to a place where the dogs went, where the trash was sent. Job is challenged with his suffering, not only in pain, but by those around him. Even his wife questions, surely God wouldn't allow this all to happen. And his friends, boy, if we could go there, I don't know if we're going to get that there in this series. They do really good in the beginning. They sit with Job and they comfort him. But then it goes kind of awry. And the friends got their opinion, and that's another part of the story for another day. In all this, Job replies, and this is his replies to his wife. Should we accept only good things from the hand of God and never anything bad? So in all of this, Job said nothing wrong. Did he doubt? Yes. Did he question? You bet. And we'll get into that later in the series. Did he get mad at God? I am guessing yes. Did he feel like giving up? Probably. But he always praised God and always kept him on course. And so I want to give you three things to close to take home with you to think about. First, that Job in his piety was always under the power of God. In his piety, in the way of his life, in his faithfulness, he was always under the power of God. We all know the Wright brothers, right? And they invented what? Yeah, airplane, flying, exactly. You know, and I wonder what went through their mind as they're trying to figure this out. I wonder if they sat on the ground and ran really fast and started to do this. Anybody think they did that? I don't know. They wanted to fly, right? And I'm guessing it didn't work very well. It feels like sometimes, at least for me, maybe not for you, that I'm flapping my arms and trying to live under the source of my own power. Doesn't work that way. I can fly. That is a fact, right? But I can't fly on my own. It'll never work. I got to get in something that is motor-driven, a turbine, or sail, wind-driven. And it's influenced by the wind and what is going on around it. Job's faith, even in human weakness, was powered by divine forces and influence. It was powered by the Spirit of God. Paul, the apostle, in Philippians 3:10 says, I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. That's the same power that helps us in our weakness. Paul also speaks in 2 Corinthians 12:10, that's why I take pleasure in my weakness and the insults and hardships and persecutions and the troubles I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong because of Christ. So how are you dealing with adversity? Are you flapping your own arms, seeking answers to your own self-pity? Or do you seek God's power and influence to sustain you? In piety, we are always under the power of God, or Job was. In his prosperity, number two, he was always under the providence of God. Providence means provide. It comes from the word provide, and pro means on behalf of, and vide means to see in Latin. Job never lost sight of God's blessing in his life. The psalmist tells us, you take care of the earth and you water it, you make it rich and fertile. The river of God is plenty of water, provides a beautiful, bountiful harvest of grain. And then in Jeremiah says, this is what the Lord says, don't let the wise boast of their wisdom or the powerful boast in their own power or the rich boast in their riches. Instead, boast in the providence of God, of God's provision. In James chapter 1, 12, the author writes, God blesses those who patiently endure temptation and testing. Afterward, they will receive the crown of life. Do you praise God for the blessings? Hopefully we do all the time, but especially in the midst of difficulties. In prosperity, Job always was under the providence of God, and in predicament, he was always under God's protection. Job was never alone in his affliction. God never abandoned him, and God never caused him harm. The faithful are always under heaven's protection. I was thinking this past week of, I know there's a couple of our students in our church that are in the midst of driver's training. And driver's training is fun, right? Right, Todd and Stacy? Yeah, it's so cool. Kind of, sort of, yeah. You know, sometimes we're eager and we want to just, yeah, go, take it, do it. And then, you know, it just depends. Eventually, they drive on their own, right? The student learns enough, but they're always under our care, aren't they, in a sense? We're always wanting to protect them as parents. But the truth is, when we let them go, the dangers still exist, don't they? Just get in the car. Ever had anybody pull out in front of you? The dangers still exist. And at some point, we need to trust them into God's hands by teaching them of God's providence and protection, and by teaching them how to live under his power and in his strength. You see, there's a mindset that declares faith protects, that faith earns a bubble that ensures nothing bad will happen. We know that's not true, but that is why often those who are stricken abandon their faith because they believe that God has not kept his promise. If God doesn't keep up God's end of the bargain, then why should I do this anymore? Or so goes the thinking. But that has never been the promise. There is no bargain here about our health, our personal security, about what can happen. But there is a God who protects, a God who provides, no matter what we're in. In all of this, this part ends, Job did not sin by believing God. We want a fairy tale life, but that is not the world. But that doesn't mean we cannot enjoy the providence of God's blessing, the protection of God's hand. We only have to live under the power of God's influence, living a life faithful to God, in worship, in turning away from evil. The adversary still preys on a person's weakness, and if you don't think so, then you're not living in the real world, because God still allows him to roam to and fro throughout the earth, looking for our vulnerabilities, looking to lead a person into sin and to turn them away from God. First Peter writes, stay alert, watch out for your great enemy, the devil, because he prowls around like a roaring lion looking to devour you. But the good news is there's a way to overcome. There's a way to get through, and it starts and ends with Jesus when we receive him, not by doing all the right things, but by living out our faith and always praising God, no matter what. Yesterday, the youth helped us downtown with the farmer's market. And we'd been talking about a name for quite a while for our ministry, rather than just youth ministry. And we watched a movie a few weeks ago, or a couple months ago. And anyway, this verse came up, and it's quite relevant, I think, for us today and for kids as well. So we are 1031 youth, by the way. 1031 youth. I don't have a picture of it up there. But here's a scripture from 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. That's not just a message for our young people, right? It's a message for us as well. To praise God in all things and trust Him. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your gift of faithfulness, and we thank you for the blessings poured out. In a moment, we are going to share together here a reminder of that great blessing through your Son, Jesus Christ. Restore us this day, fill us, encourage us, and strengthen us. In your name, amen. We are going to move into our time of communion. In a moment, I'm going to have my servers serve you this morning. I had a couple funerals this past week and just been in some places that I was a little uncomfortable, so I will let them present this morning and keep you all safe as well. Join with me in our Apostle Creed, in our words of what we believe and profess together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It is Christ our Lord who invites us to this table. All who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live at peace with one another, therefore let us confess our sin before God and before one another. We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. While Christ died for us, he did this while we are yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. May the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy. Should be a holy in there somewhere. Yeah, keep going. Somewhere in there. Okay, well, we'll hold off on that. But let's go back one. Yeah. Okay. Get back to the Lord's Prayer. We'll do that together. How's that? I think it's on there. Now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together the prayer that the Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he gave thanks. Gave it to before God, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, He gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, of those who are hearing my voice and with us in spirit. Upon these gifts of bread and juice, make them for us be the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed for his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to the world, until Christ comes again in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Invite our stewards forward. As I said, they will come forward, present the gifts this morning that have been prayed for. In the United Methodist Church, everyone is open to receive. We invite you to come forward as you feel led and to receive the presence of Christ as we remember his body and his blood, his sacrifice for us. In a moment, the ushers will come and help you come forward.
God, we thank you for this gift of grace which we have experienced as a reminder and a moment of refreshing. God, instill in each of us that as we meander through this world that we are not alone, both in your grace and goodness and in the evils of the world. But God, we don't have to stay there because we are and can be under your protection, under your providence, as we live lives of faithfulness for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, let's stand and sing. How's that? And we're, guess what? We're going to sing a song called Blessed Be Your Name. Such fitting. I threw myself for a loop when I picked both of these songs on the same Sunday because they almost have the same title and they're totally different. So, Blessed Be Your Name.
You give and take.
Oh, certainly I get an amen.
Amen.
Blessed be your name. How can we be a blessing to others? The blessings we've received. Well, I have an opportunity for you in case you're wondering. Grace Centers of Hope, the team will be going there this month again, and so get with Pat Snyder or Tammy Felt, and we are in need of one person for that serving day to serve in the kitchen there. It is a blessed experience, and I hope that I know somebody will step up. We are going to be doing this monthly, and amongst the many other ways that you can serve in this church as well. So, and then let us join together after our time here downstairs for a time of fellowship, food, conversation, and coffee. God bless you. Amen.
Yeah. Oh, no, I won't stand next to you.